lanterns, pots and pans, every necessity of life from the Chinese side. The Karmapa was supposed to be smuggled through aboard one of these trucks and then sent by helicopter to the Nepali capital of Kathmandu. But something went wrong with the plan.
The Chinese border guards at the Takiu checkpoint were stunned to see two land cruisers rush past in the darkness.
4 miles into Nepal, the road splits at the customs post, but the driver takes the wrong turn right into a stone wall. Using a radio phone, the Karmapa's group of 5 monks contact the smugglers, who arrive and take them to safety in the darkness. What happens next astonished the local people. On the next morning, the Chinese police came back. The doors of the Toyota had been left unlocked, and the keys were still in the ignition. The Chinese drove the Karmapa's land cruiser a short distance into Tibet, and then they demolished the vehicle as if trying to destroy evidence. What happened to the second land cruiser? It seems to have vanished into thin air. This second car belongs to one of the richest Tibetan merchants in Lhasa, who happens to be the world's biggest dealer in Pashmina wool. He and his Toyota resurfaced in Lhasa 10 days later. According to the press in India, this merchant is a secret agent of China's Public Security Bureau. The Land Cruiser was a gift from officials in the Tibetan Autonomous Region, who eagerly supported his plans to return the Black Crown to Tibet. Ogyen Trinley Dorje was, and still is, the darling of the regional government. He was pampered like a prince by the Tibetans and the Chinese. At the age of 4, this son of poor fur trappers was thrust into the limelight when a powerful Kagyupa monk named Taisi Tupa chose him as a successor to the 16th Karmapa. His enthronement in Surfu Monastery outside Lhasa was nationally televised. It was a powerful symbol of the unity of Tibet with the People's Republic of China.
The decision to leave wasn't made on the spur of the moment. It was planned well in advance. As early as September, 4 months before his departure, Ogyen Trinley's attendant sought permission for a retreat in these meditation chambers above the monastery. That was a good way to explain his absence from Tibet. Ogyen Trinley left Surfu Monastery on Christmas and not on the 28th as claimed, because by the 27th, the police were already searching for him in Lhasa. They drove away on the brand new road that was built by a wealthy supporter, Chen Luan, who was one of Taiwan's top politicians. The road led to the Qinghai-Tibet Highway. Somewhere along the way, he linked up with another land cruiser owned by the Tibetan merchant. The merchant's security clearance got them past military bases and police checkpoints. Then they took the Trans-Tibet Highway that leads to sacred Mount Kailas. According to officers at this Royal Nepal Army base, Ogyen Trinley's border crossing attempt was spotted by both the Chinese and Indian armies. A Toyota Land Cruiser with VIP license plates is worth its weight in gold in Tibet, and Ogyen Trinley wanted to park it in a safe place. So his men in Mustang rented 2 Russian-built Mi-16 helicopters inside Nepal to airlift the vehicle deeper into Nepal's Dopal region. The Russian helicopters came too close to the border and were detected by radar on the Chinese side. The big Chinese army base at Perang put the border guards on alert. The Indian security forces picked up the Chinese alert and figured that Ogyen Trinley was attempting a border crossing. India sent hundreds of armed policemen to the Tinkar Pass on the Nepal border to intercept him. With two Asian superpowers now on alert, Ogyen Trinley's secret border crossing was blown. There was only one course left, a mad dash in the Mustang. At 1 in the afternoon, December 29th, a Kathmandu monk named Gyaltsen Lama received an urgent phone call. He had visited Surfu 2 years earlier to pledge his support for this Karmapa. Now was his time to come through.
Tell us what he said on the phone. What did he
say? Ready to come over here. You have it. We don't know where we go.
The lanky 6-foot-tall monk, better known as the Tall Monangi, was the right man for the job. He drove to Pokhara and then took a plane to Jomsom in Lower Mustang. He hired horses from pony guide Kancha Gurung, and they rode up the Kali Gandaki River far into the night. On the next morning at 5, they rendezvoused with Ogyen Trinley, his monks from Surfu, and Chawang Lama, a brother of Subarnabhista, the main escape organizer in Mustang. They rode through snowfall. Ogyen Trinley didn't realize that he was passing through a land that was once the base for Operation Shadow Circus, the CIA's secret war in Tibet. After Gami, they took the steep path over Nyala Pass, through Shamboche, and then Samar at nightfall. It was 9 at night when they reached the most dangerous part of the trail. The locals say a lot of horses and porters have fallen to their deaths here. With flashlights in hand, the porters led the horses across the pass one at a time. In the next village, Chile, lodgekeeper Gyanuma Gurung was preparing a meal for her special guests.
After the meal, the pony guide Kancha Gurung became angry at the tall monk from Anang. They were arguing outside.
I'm still angry at that Monangi. I told him my horses weren't going any further. They were tired and freezing.
He calmed down and then they rode off.
They turned to the east. At 6 in the morning, freezing and hungry, they took a chance and knocked on the door of a total stranger.
I heard people knocking on the door saying, "Lamas, lamas, let us in." They were shivering, so I made a fire inside the room. I asked if there was a big lama with them, but they said no.
After drinking tea and eating noodles and biscuits, they left without blessing or even thanking their hosts.
You see, I wanted a blessing for my deceased husband and for the baby, but they wouldn't give us one. I can't die in peace now. Where was his compassion? How can that young lama call himself the Karmapa?
They got on their horses again and faced the biggest challenge yet. Thank you.